A legal appeal on the Ontario Doctors' Conscience Rights issue.
The irony of this is that they say they're doing this to improve access. They're actually, I think, going to make access more difficult. For one thing, many doctors are going to leave those rural settings, and they may leave Canada altogether.
On the feature interview today, Larry Worthen from the Christian Medical and Dental Society of Canada on the implications of that new conscience rights policy for doctors in Ontario. On the news, ARPA was part of a press conference in Ottawa last week, drawing attention to the erosion of religious freedom in Canada. Some affirmation from Sweden that Canada's on the right track with its new prostitution laws. The Trinity Western accreditation case in Nova Scotia is going back to court. And we take a look back at the success of the movie, The Dropbox.
And now, Lighthouse News. Lighthouse News is a presentation of ARPA, the Association for Reform Political Action. Here's your host, Al Sebring.
ARPA lawyer Andre Schutten took part in a press conference in Ottawa this past week to draw attention to the increasing erosion of religious freedoms in Canada. There were four other Christian-based faith groups there as well, and they focused on things such as the Trinity Western case, new provincial education policies in Alberta and Ontario, and various municipal land use decisions against churches, all to illustrate that Christians in particular are being singled out for discriminatory treatment by governments at various levels across the country. The event prompted a statement of the House of Commons later that day from Langley MP Mark Warowa.
Canada is recognized as a country that advocates for human rights and religious freedoms internationally. Canada's excellent international reputation is due to our government's strong stand on human rights and the outstanding work of Canada's Ambassador for Religious Freedoms. We also need to focus on the religious freedoms in Canada to protect the charter rights of all Canadians. Religious freedoms are integral to the fabric of the Canadian identity. It's at the core of who we are as a tolerant and pluralistic society. Mr. Speaker, recent intolerant attacks on religious freedoms in Canada are being condemned. I call on all members of this House to commit themselves to protect our religious freedoms.
The event did not generate a lot of coverage in the national media, but the CBC did put a text story up on their website. We linked to that from our homepage at Lighthouse News this week. The story itself is a fairly accurate representation of the contents of the press conference, but the most interesting thing about that CBC story is the comments that it generated. A vast majority of the people commenting ridiculed the idea that Christians are in any way being singled out for negative treatment, and a good many of them also expressed strong views that the idea of religion should be absolutely separated from the realms of politics or governance, particularly in a secular society. Andre Schutten says, really, that argument comes down to a misunderstanding of the nature of secularism.
So many people have this twisted idea that secular means neutral, but it's not. So when people ask me, you know, where is this coming from? Where is this erosion of religious liberty coming from? I'm telling them that it's coming from another religion, and that religion in Canada is called secularism. Secularism is not neutral. It is every bit as religious as the Christian or the Sikh or the Jewish faith. And I think perhaps one of the bigger problems is that many people in Canada call themselves Christians. I think the stats are upwards of 70% of Canadians would call themselves Christians, either because they're baptized in the Roman Catholic faith or they go to church every Christmas and Easter or something like that. But the reality is that most of those people are actually secularists who just call themselves Christians in a cultural sense. So I think we in the Reform community, a big job for us is to point this out every time. There's no neutrality, and secularism is a religion, and it's being taught in all of our public schools, and it infuses most of our public policy.
In other news, if you've been following ARPA's policy documents from the beginning, you'll know that the very first of these submissions dealt with the regulation of prostitution in Canada. It was put forward in September of 2011 and argued that Canada should take up the Swedish model when it comes to this issue. Rather than prosecuting sex trade workers, they should be protected from human trafficking. The law should instead go after the traffickers, the pimps, and the consumers. The federal government passed the Canadian version of the Swedish law late last year, and now there's a report from Sweden which indicates that this kind of approach has been a huge success there. Street prostitution in Sweden has been cut by more than half since 1995. Margaret Wente wrote an analysis of the Swedish situation in the Globe and Mail a few weeks ago. While that analysis doesn't mention ARPA by name, it is in many respects a strong endorsement of the policies for which our organization started advocating 4 years ago. We link to the column from our homepage this week. Couple of legal cases to update you on. In Ontario, the College of Physicians and Surgeons is being taken to court over its new so-called conscience rights policy for doctors. Several organizations announced the legal challenge at a Toronto press conference last week. Dr. Michelle Korvamacher is an emergency ward and family doctor in Woodstock, Ontario. She says, really, there's a very simple problem with the new policy.
The College of Physicians and Surgeons of Ontario's new policy would require me to engage in and facilitate an abortion, which would be contrary to my conscience and religious beliefs.
We'll have more on this story on the feature interview in a few minutes with the head of the Christian Medical and Dental Society of Canada. Also on the legal front, Trinity Western University is going to be facing more legal bills as it defends its attempts to start up a Christian law school in BC. You'll recall that back in January, a judge in Nova Scotia ruled against the Barristers' Society there when it announced it would not be accepting graduates from any new law school at Trinity Western. The ruling from Mr. Justice Jamie Campbell said the Law Society was clearly overstepping its legal bounds in trying to regulate the practices of a law school in another province. Barry Bussey is the Director of Legal Affairs with the Canadian Council of Christian Charities. He says the appeal seems to be more about making a political statement than arguing the points of law in Justice Campbell's ruling.
When you read the release of the Nova Scotia Barristers Society, the fact that they are now wanting to take on, and I'm using their words, a wider role in promotion of equality in all aspects of its work, we can see exactly that Justice Campbell was spot on. They're wanting to move beyond and let's get involved in promoting equality at the expense of religious freedom. And that, to me, I just find absolutely amazing. I mean, I kind of thought that when they would announce their appeal, they would make some reference to the fact that Justice Campbell made some error in judgment in law or something along that. But no, there was no discussion of the legal side. Now, of course, they will make some legal arguments, I'm sure, with their appeal documents. But their opening statement as to their appeal and the rationale for their appeal, to me, is just totally unacceptable.
Bussey says at the end of the day, it's critical that cases like this are resolved so that we have a clear understanding of competing rights in Canadian society.
The most important thing that we've got to realize in this country is that we have all come from very different walks of life. We have all different opinions, different ways in which we want to understand how we ought to live. But here's the thing. We all live on the same real estate, and we've got to be able to come to a place where we can allow people who are different from us to be able to have space on the same property. And this whole issue with Trinity Western is simply a case of a religious community that came together, started a religious university. They want to follow their understanding of marriage as one man and one woman. And is there no place in Canada where we can allow a religious community to be able to do that? The law is very clear that says, yes, there is.
Bussey has written an excellent blog entry on this case. It's online, and we link to it from the Lighthouse News homepage this week. And one thing more this week. Not sure if you've seen the movie The Drop Box. It's about a South Korean pastor who installed, literally, a drop box outside his home for unwanted babies, many with physical and other disabilities. The movie was brought to Canada by Focus on the Family, which partnered with the Cineplex chain to show it at theaters around the country. Derek Roguski with Focus says it was a huge success. Cineplex came back and asked for more showings in some cities. That phase of the project is pretty much done now, but Roguski says the movie will be out on DVD in a few months, and you can pre-order your own copy now from their website.
The DVD of The Dropbox will be coming out later this summer, early fall, and so people can certainly get a DVD of it. I encourage them to come to thedropboxfilm.ca and actually just see more small videos of Canadians who have just seen a need in their community and have responded to it, because that's really what this film is about. It's just really inspiring people where maybe they've seen a need, maybe they've seen something that really wrestles in their soul, and they've responded to it, just like Pastor Lee responded to the fact of abandoned babies in Seoul, Korea. We can begin to respond to needs in our communities.
Again, that website, thedropboxmovie.ca. Back with more after this.
Have you checked out ARPA Canada on Facebook or Twitter lately? Social media is a great way to get information communicated quickly to your network. We regularly post news, pictures, and videos, and our posts are easy to share, either from our pages or directly from our website to your own Facebook and Twitter. We would be so grateful if you would help us bring a Christian perspective by sharing our posts with your friends.
And we're back on the program. As you heard in the news portion of the show, the new so-called conscience rights policy adopted by the College of Physicians and Surgeons in Ontario a few weeks ago is going to be challenged in court. The challenge being launched by the Christian Medical and Dental Society of Canada. And with me on the program today is that society's executive director, Larry Worthen. Larry, first of all, welcome to the show.
My pleasure to be here.
Talk to me a little bit, first of all, about your specific components of the new policy that this legal challenge is going after. What is in there that is so problematic?
Well, essentially, the policy itself erodes established conscience protections for physicians. It erodes it in two ways. It requires a referral for a procedure, even though the procedure goes against the conscience rights of the physician. And in addition, in some circumstances, it actually requires the physician to perform the procedure, even though it goes against their conscience.
Specifically, you say there are certain instances where they might still be able to opt out and perhaps refer, although that is problematic, I think, for some doctors. There's other instances where even the referral thing isn't an option?
Absolutely. For many of our physicians, to refer for something, particularly things like abortion and euthanasia, are morally the same as actually performing those things. You know, in Canada, we're very often reluctant to extradite someone who's committed murder to a country where they have the death penalty. And the reason for that is that we consider the death penalty to be morally abhorrent. And so we will not refer someone to a place where they're in jeopardy of actually having that happen. This is the situation that doctors are going to be in with euthanasia. If they refer, they know that that's going to end in the termination of the life of their patient, and they find that morally objectionable.
What are the legal grounds for the challenge? You have a law degree. You've presumably done a little bit of work on this. Is this a charter-based challenge? What are we doing here?
Absolutely. The second section of the charter protects Canadians' freedom of conscience and freedom of religion. We believe that the CPSO is directly covered by the charter because it's a creature of statute in the province of Ontario. So therefore, they must protect physicians' conscience in any of the policies that they developed. And in this case, as I've already said, they really make mincemeat of conscience protections for physicians in Ontario.
So I want to back up. You know, we've been following this on Lighthouse News for a while, and we were urging people to take part in the public consultation process late last year. What do you think precipitated this CPSO decision to go in this direction? I mean, was it based on an honest assessment of the public input that they asked for? Or was there some kind of, politics at play here? Was this a foregone conclusion?
Unfortunately, we're coming to that conclusion. We had some informal discussions with them that indicated they were headed in this direction before they even started the consultation. They did some surveys where they claimed that a majority of the public was in favor of requiring referral. But when you actually go to their website and look at all of the submissions, there were something like 1,600 submissions just in the last couple of weeks. Those are 80 to 85% against the policy and in favor of protecting conscience rights. So it appears to us as though this consultation was just so that they could say that they had listened to the public, when in actual fact, no matter what the public said, it didn't sway them from the direction they were headed.
Ontario is not the only province that's dealing with this stuff. I mean, there's a similar policy sort of in the wings in Saskatchewan, and it's been well documented. There was a meeting between the folks in Saskatchewan and Ontario, and they seem to be driving a bus that wants to get both provinces on sort of the same wavelength with this. Is this part of a larger national agenda?
Yes, absolutely. There's an organization called the Conscience Project who got money from the Canadian Institute of Health Research, led by two or three academics. And they made it very clear that they were out to develop conscience policies from a feminist perspective. They don't claim to be objective, and they were able to get some of the registrars of some of the colleges on their committee. And so now they are trying to promote this draft policy in various colleges across Canada. What we're saying is, look, let's be fair about this. Let's have doctors like our doctors at the table so we can discuss what our concerns are. because our doctors are directly affected. It's their practices that will have to change, or it's them who will have to go to the States to practice there. Let's have us at the table so we can talk about our perspectives and make this a truly inclusive project and not just a one-sided project.
You mentioned the possibility of some doctors going to the States to practice there. That sort of brings up an interesting question. What are some of the sort of unintended consequences here? I'm thinking, for example, of small towns across this country that are, you know, faced with a doctor shortage and they're trying to recruit. Presumably, in those small towns, you'd have a higher proportion of Christian doctors. I don't know. I mean, I have no statistics to back that up. That just seems to me to be likely to be true.
I think you're right.
So what are those kind of consequences for, in this case, small town Ontario?
The irony of this is that they say they're doing this to improve access. They're actually, I think, going to make access more difficult. For one thing, many doctors are going to leave those rural settings, and they may leave Canada altogether. That's the first thing. The second concern is that by requiring a referral, you actually, in some cases, make access to services more cumbersome. Let me explain what I mean. Most of our doctors, when a patient finds out that they have an unwanted pregnancy, would be very, very sensitive to the patient's distress, because this is a difficult time in anyone's life. They would spend time counseling them. They would help them identify what their values were, and they would help them come to a decision about the pregnancy and what they wanted to do. If the physician is a physician of conscience and is unable to do a referral, they would discuss that with the patient. If the patient wanted to go ahead with the abortion, then the doctor would simply say, you can self-refer for this. This policy would require referral when one is not even required. So it just doesn't make sense. It requires actually more red tape and paperwork because of the policy than it would otherwise.
Final question, just a process issue as far as the lawsuit goes. When is this going to get into court, and any predictions how long it's going to take?
Well, we're hoping to get into court within about 6 months. This is not an action where one party sues another. This is actually an application that we've made to court to have the policy revised or some section of it struck down by the court because it's unconstitutional. So we're hoping that because it's a streamlined process, that in about 6 months, we could actually get before a judge.
And then after that, it's another 3 or 4 months before we get a decision. So we're close to a year out.
That's what it appears. We may actually consider asking for an interim injunction to see if we can get the courts to stop the actual application of the policy until the time that the courts have heard it and made an assessment of its constitutional validity.
Larry, thank you very much. We're out of time.
God bless. Appreciate your attention to this.
We'll certainly keep watching this. It's a very interesting case.
I appreciate that. And if people want to learn more about this, they can go to our website at cmdscanada.org.
Thank you, sir. And just a quick programming note to wrap up. It's Easter this coming weekend. That means there'll be no edition of Lighthouse News. Look for the next one to be delivered to your inbox or on the website on April 13th.
This has been Lighthouse News, delivering news and commentaries on today's current events to equip Christians for their task in the public square. Production manager, Brian Grimm. Technical Director, Nate Bosher. Questions or feedback? You can leave us an audio comment by clicking on the answering machine button at the top of the Lighthouse News homepage. Or you can send us an email, info@arpaccanada.ca. Be sure to join us again in 2 weeks for another edition of Lighthouse News.